In 1912, the German Oriental Company, led by the archaeologist Ludwig Burckhardt, was conducting a dig at Amarna in Egypt. During that dig, they came upon a site that turned out to have been the workshop of a sculptor called Tutmosis. Suddenly, Burckhardt and his friends found themselves surrounded by unfinished sculpture. Among them, the bust of Nefertiti that is today kept at the Neues Museum in Berlin. This is the story of the Nefertiti bust and its place both in modern and in ancient history. Welcome to Ancient History. I am your host, Morten Eriksson. Since then, the story of the Nefertiti bust has been filled with controversies. I shall not cover all those arguments, nor the fascinating story of Nefertiti herself. Those stories will surely be appropriate subjects for future episodes. In this episode, I shall focus on the controversy of the bust's provenance, a debate that took on more or less immediately after the find and is still circulating, even though modern science has proved the bust to be authentic. The Nefertiti bust is a beautiful limestone sculpture coated with a stucco layer and a meticulous paint job. It is today one of the most famous and copied of all Egyptian or even ancient sculptural finds. The quality of the bust is so extraordinary that Burckhardt, with astonishment, wrote about the find that it was almost indescribable and that the only way to grasp it was to see it. And although the bust itself has no inscription, Nefertiti can be identified both through her facial features and by the characteristic crown found in other identifiable sculptures. Her face has exquisite feminine lines and has become a symbol of timeless beauty. In fact, the sculpturing is so good that this fact has been a large part of the foundation of the claims that the sculpture is a product of falsification. The woman depicted in the bust has features that could easily be translated to modern ideals. Nefertiti, whose name fittingly means the beautiful one has come forth, was born around 1370 BC and died about 1313. She became the great royal wife of the pharaoh Akhenaten, who reigned in the years 1353 to 1334, those years being somewhat uncertain. This places her in the time of the New Kingdom era, but little else is known about the historical Nefertiti. Although it is possible that she became a pharaoh in her own right after the death of Akhenaten. The bust itself is believed to have been crafted in about the year 1345. The limestone sculpture is a large piece, weighing about 20 kilograms and measuring almost half a meter in height. The face is intact, and apart from the damaged ears, only one significant feature is missing, her left eye. The still remaining eye has a pupil of quartz with black paint and is fixed to the eye socket with beeswax. It could be added that there is a possibility that the second eye never existed. It has been proposed that the sculpture was a learning model for the craftsman in Tutmosis' workshop. She's wearing the characteristic blue crown with its golden diadem band tied together the back of the crown, and a cobra, the uraeus, used to be seen on the forefront, but has since long been lost to history. Nefertiti's neck is long, much too long for a human neck. Nonetheless, it adds to her slim aesthetic features and in an almost regal way exaggerates the weight of the head and of the crown. Around her neck, she is wearing a collar of floral patterns. Her face is almost perfectly symmetrical, with high cheekbones, a pronounced mouth, with red painted lips. And what is interesting is that what Tutmosis portrays is not a girl or a young woman. Nefertiti is a mature woman at the height of her existence. The process of how the bust ended up in Germany is filled with its own controversies that will not be covered here, but the sculpture made it to Europe just in time for the War of 1914. For different reasons, the bust was then kept secret for a long while, both before and after the Great War, a fact that has also been part of the falsification claim. It was donated to the Berlin Museum in 1920, but was not revealed to the public until 1923. Later, it was displayed in the Berlin Neues Musem until the outbreak of the Second World War in 1939. Then, After initially being stored in the Prussian governmental bank for safekeeping, it was again moved in 1941 to the tower of a flak bunker. At the end of the war, as the situation in Berlin became more desperate, the bust was, in early March 1945, moved yet again, this time to a salt mine in Merkers Kieselbach in Thüringen, some 400 kilometers southwest of Berlin. And later that month, the bust was found by the American army and handed over to the legendary monuments man, who had been sent abroad to find and save the art treasures of Europe. Soon, the bust was again put on display, this time in Wiesbaden in 1946. The emerging DDR made a claim the same year for the bust to be returned to the Museum Island in East Berlin, where it had been kept before the war. It was, however, to be until October 2009 before she finally returned to Neues Museum, where she still resides today. In the same year, the Swiss art historian Henri Stierlin, in his book The Bust of Nefertiti, A Fraud in Egyptology, claimed that the bust seen today is fake. Stierlin claims that the sculpture was made in order to test ancient pigments, but had later been said to be real for the convenience of Borchardt. He puts forward a series of arguments, for example, the fact that it took 11 years from the actual find to the first display of the work. Also in the same year, the Berlin-based author Erdogan Erkivan made similar claims that the bust was not an original, but in fact a falsification crafted in the 20th century. Erkivan suggests that Borchardt's wife was the actual model for the sculpture. And perhaps it is in fact possible to see some facial similarities between the features of his wife Emily Cohen and Nefertiti. It is, however, easy to find such similarities in many female faces, as did, for example, Linda Christian, when her photo was taken beside the bust to show the likeness between her and Nefertiti. Another conspiracy theory that took hold claims that Adolf Hitler had a copy of the bust made already in the 1930s, having, like everyone else, fallen in love with the striking sculpture. The original would then have been destroyed during the war. All these theories have been dismissed by the scientific community, both by archaeologists, historians, and by the natural sciences. Radiological tests, tomography, and material analysis has shown the bust to be authentic. Further, the color pigments have been proved to match those used by the ancient craftsmen. Adding to this, Egyptian officials has also dismissed the theories, calling the authors delirious. Stierlin, then, being an art historian, has also argued that the sculpturing technique used for the shoulders of the bust, being cut vertically, does not match the common Egyptian technique of cutting shoulders horizontally. To answer that claim, the Egyptian archaeologist Sahih Hawass has argued that this style in fact changed during the reign of Akhenaten. In 2006, while trying different lighting positions on the piece, the director of the Berlin Egyptian Museum observed what appeared to be wrinkles on Nefertiti's neck and bags under her eyes. This suggested a try to depict signs of aging. A CT scan done the same year confirmed these findings and at the same time established the authenticity of the bust. These features of her face had later, it appeared, been covered or smoothened by the stucco layer. No matter if the bust is a fake or, as science and expertise has found, is in fact genuine. Queen Nefertiti, as shown in the Berlin bust, has become a symbol of beauty and femininity in our own time, just as much so probably as she was in her own. During the 20th century, Nefertiti's face became idolized and iconic and remains so. Nothing can be argued against the fact that it is an extraordinarily beautiful sculpture, with features signaling universal aesthetic perfection. Perhaps one of the major reasons the theories of falsification have been able to flourish are those timeless features of unparalleled beauty so close to our own ideals. And perhaps also that no other find, although there are plenty of extraordinary Egyptian sculpture, comes close to the perfection of her eternal face. In fact, the controversies reveal, in a fashion fitting antiquity, our willingness to go to war over beauty. If you enjoyed this video, please push that like button or even consider subscribing to my channel or join me at Patreon.